This is total war. We are fighting a variety of enemies. There are lots of them out there. All this talk about first we are going to do Afghanistan, then we will do Iraq. This is entirely the wrong way to go about it. If we just let our vision of the world go forth and we embrace it entirely and we don't try to piece together clever diplomacy but just wage a total war, our children will sing great songs about us years from now. End quote. That was said by Richard Perle of the Project for the New American Century. According to neoconservative ideology, the ultimate objective of capitalism is to maximize financial profits by the monopolization of all commerce via the systematic acquisition of the entire planet's resources by any means necessary. Globalization, deregulation of trade, and ever-increasing powers of the international banking elite have made that objective an easily achievable reality. In 1997, arch neocon Richard Perle, along with former World Bank chief Paul Wolfowitz, former US Vice President Dick Cheney, and former Secretary of Defense Donald Rumsfeld, co-founded the Project for the New American Century, the corporatist think tank whose openly aggressive militaristic policies were at the black heart of the George W. Bush administration. The politicians implementing these policies were representing the interests of the Council on Foreign Relations, the Trilateral Commission, the Royal Institute of International Affairs, the Bilderberg Group, the Club of Rome, and other roundtable groups. A corporate cabal of the same interlocking vested interests that have dominated geopolitical events since the Battle of Waterloo. At the nexus of this unaccountable power and influence are the Rothschild and Rockefeller international banking dynasties, considered by some researchers to be the secret rulers of the world. They stand accused of manipulating and controlling almost every nation on Earth through their complex web of multinational corporations, hand-picked governments, educational institutions, charitable foundations, and central banks, which they ruthlessly dominate for their own private gain. Quote, world events do not occur by accident. They are made to happen, whether it is to do with national issues or commerce, and most of them are staged and managed by those who hold the purse strings. End quote. That was said by Dennis Healey, former British Chancellor and Secretary of Defense, as quoted by Daniel Estelin in The True Story of the Bilderberg Group, 2007. As many eminent financial experts have already noted, the onset of the Great Depression in 1929 was preceded by a false dawn of a financial upturn. What followed in the autumn of 2008, which was ironically dubbed the credit crunch, seems to have been an attempted demolition of the planet's monetary system. Continued research and further reflection have revealed that the entire fiasco may have been a wholly manufactured financial panic perpetrated to distract the people from the institutionalized crimes of the banksters, thousands of whom now stand accused of multiple global frauds, and to prepare the masses for a new global currency, one world government, and a tax on the air they breathe in the guise of the green monster commonly known as environmentalism. Essential to sustaining the banksters' control of the planet's resources are the suppression of recyclable free energy technologies, the waging of permanent unwinnable wars, the destruction of self-sufficient sovereign nations, and the implementation of a worldwide carbon tax. Billions of people on this planet are already dying of starvation and preventable diseases, or face losing their homes and livelihoods as a result of contrived social, financial, and environmental collapse. In reality, we already have the technology and resources to radically reduce and ultimately eradicate the chemical and radioactive pollution of this planet. But the argument that carbon dioxide, the naturally occurring gas which animals breathe out and plants breathe in, is responsible for any fluctuation in the Earth's temperatures or damage to the biosphere is simply not sustained by the facts. When the truth about the great global warming scam becomes common knowledge, and the physical application of existing technology becomes widely available to the people, free energy will naturally replace the dirty, artificially expensive fuels of the oil, gas, coal, and nuclear industries, whilst the all-encompassing power of the petrochemical industry and its money changers will quickly diminish. In our evaluation of these geopolitical events, we must continually ask ourselves, who benefits from the outcome? The answer almost always leads to the moneyed aristocracy and their network of multinational corporations, non-government organizations, think tanks, charitable foundations, and secret societies. with a legal obligation to serve shareholders' interests above all other concerns, corporate monoliths will never cease their conquest, exploitation, and pollution of this planet until they are peacefully divested of their power over mankind. This cannot happen without unprecedented change to Western society, which has been dumbed down into apathetic submission to tyrannical government by mind-numbing television, fear-based propaganda, falsified R stories, poisoned food, toxic vaccines, and fluoridated water. Meanwhile, almost unnoticed by the great masses of people, political dissent edges ever closer to becoming recognized as an act of terrorism by the courts, whilst deregulation of trade has granted the corporation more freedom and privacy than the individual. In the heartlands of the bloated, paranoid, cuckolded West, the time has never been so ripe for radical change. Nevertheless, violent political revolution is not, was not, and will never be the answer to our problems, no matter how much brutality and injustice we encounter. Violence only ever ends when one side refuses to engage in it, and it is far more courageous to refrain from engaging in it when threatened with violence than it is to simply lash out. Notwithstanding the fact that we all have the unalienable right to defend ourselves and our loved ones from such an attack by whatever reasonable force is necessary. However, claiming that the cold-blooded murder of government operatives is somehow justified when the people are being oppressed by the state is akin to taking the Machiavellian position that the ends justify the means of achieving them. For these reasons, I wholeheartedly oppose the murder of our oppressors and vigorously advocate using all forms of reasonable force in defense of the violent actions of the same. The most enduring political myth of the 20th century was undoubtedly the left-right political paradigm, the almost universal belief that socialism is the ideological opposite of capitalism. In reality, both are mere political fronts for collectivism, the corporatist system which grants unaccountable power to the controllers of the money supply, who order society for the supposed greater good, necessitating the sacrifice of the birthrights of the individual and the consolidation of power and wealth into the hands of the self-appointed controllers, for whom different rules apply. By the end of the first decade of the 21st century, it was obvious that big business secretly merged with the state long ago, if there was ever a time when the two were mutually exclusive. While freedom and privacy are increasingly perceived as surplus to the requirements of national security and economic growth, otherwise known as authoritarian governance and corporate revenues, only when everybody possesses the means to sustain themselves and their families, without taxation and iniquity, will we be able to accurately gauge whether greed is an inevitable proclivity of the human condition or a psychological imposition by the engineers of the social system, which cannot function without our ignorance of who and what we really are. In the words of the former governor of the Bank of England, Sir Josiah Stamp, which were attributed to him by Silas W. Adams in The Legalized Crime of Banking, 1958, quote, "Banking was conceived in iniquity and was born in sin. The bankers own the earth. Take it away from them, but leave them the power to create deposits, and with the flick of the pen they will create enough deposits to buy it all back again. However, take it away from them, and all the great fortunes like mine will disappear, and they ought to disappear, for this would be a happier and better world to live in. But if you wish to remain the slaves of the bankers, and pay the cost of your own slavery, let them continue to create deposits." End quote. We are all capable of murder, but the vast majority of us never choose to fulfill that violent potential. Similarly, even though we are all capable of greed, most of us would settle for enough in life, rather than too much, given the rational choice between the two. The super-rich global elite, on the other hand, seem to believe that only having everything is ever going to be enough, including the power to determine the genetics, birth, and existence of all life on Earth. Despite centuries of apparent revolution, the surviving royal and religious dynasties of Europe, all of whom are of Germanic aristocratic lineage, have lost little of their hereditary privilege, even if they have divested much of their former power and influence to the House of Rothschild, with whom they consolidated corporate interests, bloodlines, and political influence. Debt enslavement, perpetual wars, and control of the flow of information are the weapons that have been used against mankind with such startling effectiveness that most people believe that their governments would never lie to them, even when faced with overwhelming proof of their self-serving dishonesty or tyrannical criminality. All too often, the truth appears much less attractive than the blind delusions of the path of least resistance, especially when we have yet to realize that we are all responsible for the well-being of mankind and the beautiful planet we were born to share in peace, freedom, natural harmony, and abundance. Many of the rights that we once knew to be unalienable in Britain and the so-called Commonwealth nations, such as habeas corpus and the right to be presumed innocent, appear to have been stripped from us by statute black magic, enacted in the name of fighting invisible enemies post 9/11, while the power and size of the state continue to increase, seemingly without restriction, in all corners of the globe. The inevitable choice we face is whether to build new social systems ourselves or entrust our children's future to the families who have engineered social, economic, cultural, and environmental catastrophe for profit and power, murdering hundreds of millions of people in the process of realizing the Malthusian genocide so openly endorsed by lost souls such as Prince Philip, the purported Duke of Edinburgh, who publicly stated that he hopes to be reincarnated as a deadly virus in his next life in order to cull mankind to a more manageable number. We can't say we haven't been warned. We are all the architects of our own experience on this planet, but until we are prepared to question everything we hold as self-evident truth, we will continue to live our lives in parallel states of paranoia, guilt, shame, confusion, addiction, and lust. Mesmerized by the grand illusions of the moneyed aristocrats, the last place we usually look for the answers is within. When we do, we discover that they were there all along. Just like the spirit of mankind that will rise up like a phoenix from the ashes when all hope appeared to be lost during the darkest days of our current age.